Hi, this is Nicole Kelly, and this is She Brew in the City. If you like what you hear and want to hear more of it, you can subscribe and also follow me on Instagram at She Brew in the City to see what my life is like day to day. I'm also on Patreon if you'd like to have access to some special episodes and offers. Looking for tips and tricks on a new city? Top Dog Tours is the best place to check out walking tours. We are in Boston, Philadelphia, Toronto, and New York City. Visit us on topdogtours.com to book your tour today and check us out on social media for offers, discounts, and pictures. This is Nicole Kelly, and this is She Brew in the City, and this is our first informational episode. So half of our episodes roughly are going to be interviews with people, and then roughly the other half are going to be informational episodes where we're going to talk about everything from holidays to the Holocaust to something topical possibly. And this first episode is going to be about Hanukkah, and I'm here again with my husband and producer and editor, Patrick Kelly.
Hello. I'm excited to light some menorahs and get down about Hanukkah.
So Hanukkah actually starts tomorrow. We've been recording these kind of front-loading them, so they're not actually going to be airing around the time they're recorded, but this is going to be airing, I think, in 2 days. So
yeah, this is the first one that's going to be as topical as any of
yeah.
them. It will be right on time for when it happens. And we kept pushing back this recording time, so
things kept happening.
I'm excited to get in this deep dive. You told me that what we're going to talk about is not what I think I see on all of the Instagram feeds at the moment, which are the Maccabees in 200 BC did this.
So, Patrick, when I say the word Hanukkah, what do you think of?
With my limited prior knowledge, I'm going to try to put my brain back into maybe before we were together and before we were married. But my knowledge of Hanukkah was ultimately that it was a Jewish-esque Christmas, right? That it was a day where Jewish people would get gifts. It always tended to correspond around December or Christmas time of year. And that there is some level of some ancient history, which I'm fairly familiar with because I'm a big fan of ancient history.
Is ancient history your Roman Empire? Just general ancient history?
I don't know. I'm not going to lie. I do think about the Roman Empire a lot.
That's really weird.
I do. I mean, it's so much was so important.
I didn't realize the Roman Empire was so important to men
until recently. So important. I also think about like ancient Greece and ancient Egypt.
So I'm saying ancient history in general is your Roman Empire.
Mesopotamia and all of those places. But yeah, I mean, I feel like my general understanding of like the cultural importance of Hanukkah for American Jews is definitely that it's this kind of holiday season that seems to correspond a lot with Christmas tradition in the sense of gift giving and being with your family and having this kind of warmth built up in some miracle that took place.
Yeah. So none of that was incorrect information. We're going to talk a little bit about the history of Hanukkah and kind of the traditions, but what I really want to focus in is how Hanukkah has changed in America, even within my lifetime, and how crazy that is, and the commercialization of that. We talk a little bit about this on our holiday tour. If you're in New York City at the end of November or December, please check out Top Dog Tours' holiday tour. It's very popular. We have a whole Hanukkah stop in the Diamond District.
That's why it's called the holiday tour, because we discuss Hanukkah.
It's true. But we also talk a little bit about like the commercialization of Christmas, too. So I feel like, you know, it's appropriate to talk about the commercialization of Hanukkah on this. So Hanukkah is obviously a Jewish festival, and it commemorates the recovery of Jerusalem and the rededication of the Second Temple at the beginning of the Maccabean revolt against the Seleucid Empire in the 2nd century BCE.
They were the ones, basically were formed post-Alexander the Great. So Alexander the Great had conquered most of the Middle East and parts of Egypt and stretched his empire all the way out to India. And with that, he brought with him all of this Greek culture. And these guys, after his empire died, these generals that basically broke up his empire. And that was one of them.
And Hanukkah is not mentioned in the Torah. So it's a super minor holiday that has kind of, again, blown up because of the commercialization and the association with Christmas. So basically, you know, the miracle is that there was a menorah in the temple and you needed basically consecrated ritual olive oil to light the menorah. And there was an issue with the supply chain because war tends to do that. And there was only enough oil to last one day and it lasted 8 days, which is the miracle of Hanukkah, which is why there's, you know, we light menorahs. We do a lot of cooking with oil because it's very olive oil centric. Yeah. And that's why Hanukkah is 8 days and nights, because the oil lasted 8 days. And it starts on the 25th day of Kislev in the Hebrew calendar, which is shorter than the Gregorian calendar, which is why Jewish holidays in general are always on different dates.
It is shorter.
Also why Easter is on a different date, because it correlates with a Jewish holiday. And we will talk about that in a further episode. So it's always different. This year, it's starting on December 7th. And next year, it starts on Christmas, which will make it very easy to remember.
Very Christmaka.
Well, we're going to talk about that, too.
Mm-hmm.
In 2027, it starts on Christmas Eve. And then, of course, in 2013, it was on Thanksgiving.
Yes, I remember that year.
That was the first year we lived in New York.
That's right. Your family came. It was a lot of fun.
Yeah, we did a big Thanksgiving meal. We lit the menorah. My mom gave us a menorah and we had presents, and that's not actually going to ever happen again during our lifetime.
I feel like if I had wherewithal at the time, I would have tried to combine the two holidays more, done like turkey latkes, like something really over the top.
We had just moved to New York and I feel like you weren't like seriously cooking yet at that time.
Not at that level.
Yeah, no.
No.
So I feel like you can forgive yourself for that. So going back to oil and light, we light a menorah or a Hanukkah, which has 9 branches. So for a kosher menorah, there is a branch that is either taller or to the side and taller. So it's either in the middle and taller or to the side and taller than the rest of the branches. And that's called the shamesh, which means attendant in Hebrew. Mm. And you use the shamesh to light the other candles. So that's why it may be in like a office lobby or in pictures, you know, you'll see like, why is there only one or two candles lit? It's because that correlates with the night of Hanukkah. And in the final night, all the candles are lit. I've learned a lot actually doing research for this, things that I didn't know about, like general traditions of what we do and why we do them. Apparently, it's traditional for Ashkenazi Jews for every male member of the household to have a menorah, and in a lot of families, girls as well, and they'll light, you know, every night. But
like an individual menorah.
But for Sephardic Jews, usually it's one set of lights for the entire household. Now, I'm Ashkenazi, so everyone basically gets their own menorah. Like our mom bought our daughter one on her first Hanukkah, and we have our own menorah. So I feel like at my family's Hanukkah parties, it was like a little fire hazard because there'd be like 25 menorahs just kind of being lit.
You know, I remember there being multiple menorahs being lit. I think one of the first times I went over to your aunt's house for a Hanukkah celebration. Mm-hmm. But I don't think I ever correlated that's why there were multiple menorahs.
Because everyone gets their own.
Maybe I just kind of thought like, oh, it was everyone, like the different families of your family
yeah.
getting together to light menorahs.
We would also travel with our menorah. I don't know if people do that when they go to other Hanukkah parties, but when we used to have parties at our house, there would be, you know, maybe like 50 people. So everybody would just bring their menorahs. And I don't know if that's an us family thing or an other people thing. You can let me know on Instagram if your family also brought their menorahs to other parties. But I've also seen people that like, even within the family, they'll have like maybe like 2 parents, 2 kids. The mom will really like menorahs. So they'll have lots of menorahs because there's so many different options.
Well, they're very decorative. And then some of them are really kind of over the top, like,
yeah.
like especially for little kids, like
yeah.
dinosaur menorahs
yeah.
or race car menorahs or
yeah.
superhero menorahs or whatever.
Yeah, our daughter has one that's locks that have her name on it that my mom got her on her first Hanukkah. So super interesting to me is because, you know, I'm Ashkenazi. We use the shamash to light the other candles. Apparently, Sephardic Jews will light the shamash last. And I don't know why.
That's interesting.
Yeah, I thought that was kind of weird because I thought the whole point of the shamash was to use it to light the other candles.
You said that means the attendant,
yeah.
right? Yeah.
So maybe it's like it's just attending to the other candles.
Or maybe it's more of a representation of an eternal light.
That's possible. That's possible. Yeah. If anyone knows the answer to this, please let me know.
I know. All the Sephardis out there.
Apparently, some Hasidic Jews, even if they're Ashkenazi, do this as well. I have very personal feelings about electric menorahs, but I'm reading that they're acceptable in places where you can't have fire, which makes sense, like hospitals, places where there's older people.
Or like a college dorm.
Yeah. I just feel like if it's not that kind of case, I just feel like it's kind of lazy. I don't know if that's very judgy of me, but I feel like I'm very OG. I like the actual light. I think it's really cool looking at the light of the menorah and, you know, it doesn't flicker in the same way for electric menorahs. And I feel like part of it is the candles kind of slowly go down and then they go out. Whereas an electric menorah, you literally just have to like turn the light bulb. So it's just not as, it's not as meaningful, I think. I've never done it, but I have no desire.
Well, it doesn't feel as ceremonial.
Yeah, no, look, I'm all for modernizing ceremonial objects to make your lives easier. But I feel like if you have the opportunity to have a menorah that has actual light, experiment with that. I think it's cool.
This might be a weird comparison, but it's kind of like an electric shave versus a traditional straight razing shave,
yeah,
where the ceremonial aspects of getting like a traditional shave with the foam and the hot towel and, you know, the actual closeness of that shave versus just you're in a hurry and you turn on the buzzer and you like rub it over your face and you run out the door.
I agree. I think the lighting of the menorah, you know, it's always kind of, it would always be right before presents. So we were always in a super big hurry to light the menorah to get our presents. But, you know, it's like a moment and it's supposed to be a thing. You're supposed to say blessings. And I feel like I'd say feel weird saying blessings while I'm turning a little light bulb on an electric menorah. But I never, you know, had to do it in like a dorm room or something where I think it would make sense.
Yeah.
So where do we put our menorah? Except in times of danger, which you can figure out whatever that means for you. You're supposed to be placed outside one's door or in a window on the opposite side of a mezuzah. So on the outside of the door. So this is supposed to publicize the miracle so that passersby can see it and they are reminded of this. So we put it in our window.
Well, I'm assuming when they say your door, this is in an era where you didn't live in a tenement or you didn't live in a high-rise apartment building.
Yes.
And I feel like if we put a menorah in a hallway.
If we put a little... Well, there are a lot of Jewish people in our building. So I feel like if we put our menorahs outside the door, again, it would be
a fire hazard. Yes.
So, you know, I think that's why people put it in their window. But I think I almost have a little bit of sense of pride putting it in my window. To me, especially, there's that really famous picture of the menorah in a window in Germany. And behind it across the street are these Nazi flags. So I feel like, especially with everything that's going on right now, it's also a little bit of a sense of resistance and Jewish pride in displaying it and not being afraid to display something that is so obviously Jewish. Mm-hmm. I mentioned the blessings and it being very ritualistic and, you know, taking a moment to do that. There are typically two blessings that are recited during the 8 days, but the first night you say Shehachianu, which is basically a prayer when you've come to a moment you've been excited about, or, you know, like a baby being born or going to a new school or a holiday. So it's a celebration blessing. So the first night you do the three blessings. Hanukkah is not a Sabbath-like holiday. You are under no obligation to refrain from activity. Basically, you just have to make sure you're home in time to light the menorah at sunset.
Is that what makes it more of a minor holiday than anything else? The fact that you don't have to...
There's no restrictions. There's no fasting. You can use electricity. You can use elevators. You can go in cars.
Except when it falls on like Shabbat.
Yes. So if on Shabbat, obviously, you're supposed to, if you are a Shabbat observant, to observe Shabbat and then light the menorah at the same time as the candles. But it's not like it's like, okay, it's Hanukkah, you're supposed to fast or you're supposed to not get in a car. That's, you know, it's a minor holiday. You can go to work. So it's not like you're not allowed to go and live your everyday life.
Mm-hmm.
So after lighting the candles, what do you do? If you're not going to eat dinner right away, you would obviously play a game of dreidel. Though I feel like I've never just like nonchalantly. And I will. Okay. I'm going to call some of my relatives out on this. There was a year where we were at my great aunt's house and I really wanted to play dreidel, but two of my cousins had gotten married a few months earlier and their wedding video was ready. And they were like, we can either watch the wedding video or we can pay Dreidel. And I was like, this is a really hard choice because I want to watch the wedding video. So we ended up watching the wedding video. And I don't feel like we ever like seriously played Dreidel. And I feel like that's something I want to do with our daughter.
I think I've played Dreidel seriously once, and it was during in elementary school.
Really?
The elementary school I went to was multicultural. Mm-hmm. So we had a little bit of everybody there. And anytime a holiday that was not a mainstream American holiday would mm-hmm. come up, I remember our teacher would have the kid of that
make
class
a presentation about
and
it.
And like her, maybe the parent come in and bring in food or bring in, do like a little presentation thing. And I distinctly remember one year they did the Hanukkah thing and then all the kids sat around in like little clumps and played
Dreidel.
A game of Dreidel with some gelt. And I think that was my only real true memory of sitting down and actively participating in playing Dreidel. Other than nowadays as an adult and
you're just
spinning
kind of spinning it around.
Kind of
well, people put it as like decoration on tables at parties. So it's like, what do? Do you know how to play Dreidel?
Well, I know it's a gambling game that is today mostly played with chocolate. And I know that each symbol means something else. Mm-hmm. Like every letter means you put half of your pot in or you take half the pot or you take all the pot or you lose everything.
Yeah, I could be completely wrong about this, but I remember from Hebrew school, this is the only time that you're actually allowed to gamble because Jews are not supposed to gamble. Mm. But this is allowed for some reason. I'm sure I could ask one of our rabbis about that. So the Hebrew letters on the dreidel, they kind of are an abbreviation for Nes Gadol Hayasham, meaning a great miracle happened there, referring to in Jerusalem. But apparently in Jerusalem or in Israel in general, they switch out the last letter for pes, meaning a great miracle happened here. But this is a newer thing.
I think dreidel's comparatively to Jewish history, a newer game.
I don't know exactly when this started. I'd have to look that up.
I mean, I would assume probably 1800s.
I'll have
would,
to look
you
that
know,
up.
Small shtetl somewhere.
Yeah,
somebody
that makes
started
sense.
Like spinning things. And
like, what are we going to do? Because there's nothing else to do. Mm-hmm. And we talked about gelt, which is, you know, traditionally like actual coins. But because of Americanization, and we'll talk about what company started that in a little bit, it's chocolate covered coins. So this actually comes from an Eastern European custom of children presenting their teachers with a small sum of money at this time of year as a token of gratitude is really what, you know, gelt actually is. But we've turned it into this gambling thing. We took something beautiful that children did and made it a vice.
Yeah, why not? I mean, aren't most things.
So let's talk about my favorite part about Hanukkah is the food. So, if you know, what do you think of when you think of food for Hanukkah?
Well, definitely latkes.
Mm-hmm.
I love a good latke.
Yeah.
For me, I think that is the iconic Hanukkah food.
Yeah.
I can't really think of other Hanukkah-esque foods other than latkes that are like that jump out at me.
Yeah.
I will say the jelly-filled donuts mm-hmm. as well. But that's, to me, as far as my knowledge go, I think a newer thing. I don't think I actually really knew about sufganiyot till...
Sufganiyot.
Yeah, see, I don't even say it right.
Yeah.
I'll let you talk about the donut. That was like a newer thing for me that I learned, I think, when we started giving the holiday tour. I didn't really know about those. And to be honest, I don't think I even tried one until maybe a year or two ago.
Yeah, halakas are definitely kind of a mainstay. And I want to be very clear about this. And I mentioned this on what's going to be our next episode. There is a big difference between a latke and a potato pancake. And I will fight you to the death about that. Because to me, it's about texture. And I went to Katz's and they were trying to pass off this crap as latkes, and they were potato pancakes. A potato pancake is made with mashed potatoes, and a latke is from shaved potatoes, and that is a hill I will die on.
Sure, I get. To me, they're very different.
They are. It's a texture thing.
Don't get me wrong. I enjoy a good mashed potato pancake because I feel like I don't know. My mom used to make them, especially right around after Thanksgiving. You have the leftover mashed potatoes.
But it's not, that's not a latke. It's a very different thing.
You know, I never associated the two together.
They're very different.
Yeah. Because to me, a latke is more hash brownie.
Yeah.
Than
It's crispier.
Yeah.
It's not soft on the inside. Have you ever heard of the infamous fire department latke fiasco when I was like in kindergarten?
No.
So my mom, like you, my mom was going to make latkes for the class because I think I was probably the only Jewish person. This is before I went to a private school that was predominantly Jewish. And my mom's oil got really hot and the fire alarm went off and the fire department like rolled in being like, we're here for the fire. And I was like really excited by the whole thing because a fire truck coming into your house when you're like six is very exciting.
That seems exciting.
It was exciting. And we bring it up like every year and be like, don't, when my mom makes latkes, like don't make the fire department come. So latkes are actually traditional for Ashkenazi families. A lot of other different types of Jews, and yes, there are other types of Jews, eat a lot of different things. Sephardic Jews eat bumuelos. I can't speak Spanish, which are made from flour, yeast, water, sugar, oil, and honey. So very, very different.
I think just preface everything. We apologize for mispronouncing any word that is not an English word. And we will also apologize for all the English words we mispronounce as well.
There might be a few of those too. So Sephardic, Polish, and Israeli families will eat jam-filled donuts instead of jelly. And, you know,
I don't think I really know the difference between jam and jelly.
I don't know the difference. This is something I need to ask one of my, like, chef guests. Be like, so what's the difference between jam and jelly?
I wonder if jelly is more, I guess, like, jello-y?
I don't know.
Like there's more, like it's a consistency difference or is there an actual?
Yeah, I don't know.
Yeah.
I don't know. We talked a little bit about sufganiyot, which are fried jelly donuts. And we are having those at our daughter's like class holiday party that we're hosting. And I'm excited to try them because I didn't really grow up eating those either. I don't know if it's because my family just didn't like them or it's not a big thing in LA, but they're huge here. There's a lot of places to buy them.
Yeah, maybe it's a West Coast thing.
Yeah, West Coast, East Coast.
Though I love a good donut.
Like, I love donuts.
I don't think there is like, I remember growing up, there were these little mom and pop donut shops everywhere in California. Yeah. And here you get Dunkin' and there's like nice bakeries and then like the high end donut places. There aren't a lot of mom and pop
hole in the wall
donut places where you get, you know, the classic.
I love donut.
Kind of donut. Yeah.
If you want to get me something for Hanukkah, get me some donuts. Mm-hmm. Hungarian Jews eat cheese pancakes known as kassula, which are like cheese latkes, which I want to make because what is better than cheese and potatoes together?
Yeah, that sounds great.
We need to find a recipe for that. Latkes, however, are not popular in Israel.
Really?
Yeah. I think part of this has to do with the kind of percentage of the population that is not Ashkenazi, which is the majority of Israel. So sufganiyot are much more popular there. You know, they have traditional strawberry filling, but they've also kind of messed around a little bit, you know, with chocolate cream, vanilla cream, caramel, cappuccino, and other flavors. And apparently, they're because people are trying to watch their waistlines during the holidays, you can get now mini sufganiyot, which have half the calories, which like at that point, like, why even try? You're like, you're eating a donut, eat a donut. You know, they're saying it's 400 to 600 calorie versions, which what is the real one if that's half? But, you know, if you're going to eat a donut, eat a donut. You know what I mean?
Two donuts equal like an entire day worth of calories.
Yeah.
So that sounds great.
I mean,
yeah, that's how it should be.
I guess we also used to eat roast goose. Eastern European and, you know, American Jews back in the day used to eat roast goose. I don't think I've ever eaten roast goose in my life.
I don't think I've ever had goose.
I don't think I have either.
Pate, but I've never had an actual goose. Granted, there were all of those like old English fowl things.
Isn't it in Christmas Carol in the morning he wakes up, they get a roast goose when he talks? Is it a goose or a turkey?
It depends on the translation. Sometimes it's a turkey.
Okay, well, let's be clear. In the Muppet Christmas Carol, which is...
It's probably a turkey in the Muppet Christmas Carol.
For those of you that have not seen it, this is actually the most accurate portrayal of a Christmas Carol. It just happens to have Muppets.
It's accurate in the sense that, you know...
It's the closest to the book.
To the book, and Michael Caine took it like he was doing the Royal Shakespeare Company's version.
I remember seeing that in theaters, because even though we're...
And you get two barleys for one.
Yeah,
that's great.
Because even though my family is Jewish, we used to go see Christmas movies, obviously, because, you know, it's like Christmas is now like a general American holiday for a lot of people. So I remember seeing that in theaters and loving it. And it still holds up, I think. Going back to food, Indian Jews eat fried dough balls soaked in sweet syrup, which sounds amazing.
Yeah, that's actually a popular Indian dessert. They're like honey. They're syrupy honey.
Yeah, syrupy honey. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And Italian Jews, they'll eat fried chicken. They'll eat those cheese latkes as well, and fried sweet rice cakes. So we see a theme here. Romanian Jews eat pasta latkes. I don't know what that would look like.
Hmm. You mean like shredded pasta instead of shredded potato?
Yeah, kind of like pasta.
That's interesting.
It's the not Italian Jews, Romanian Jews. Syrian Jews eat a dish made of pumpkin and bulgur wheat that are like latkes, and they also have their own version that is spiced with allspice and cinnamon.
Well, it's probably more traditional to not have potato.
Yeah.
Because potatoes weren't even introduced into Europe until around the 1500s.
Yeah.
So
for the older Jewish communities, the Mizrahi, Sephardi, mm-hmm. it would make sense that they'd be making like more sweet versions.
Yeah, and things that are non-potato based.
Yes. America gave the world the potato tomato and
a lot of things.
We were just talking about what did people eat before people found the Europeans found America.
Yeah, like North and South America is where most of these things, like it's hard to imagine that like food wasn't spicy around the world until like the Americas
was
founded.
And they didn't have chocolate.
No chocolate.
Yeah.
No peppers. Like Indian food wasn't spicy.
That's crazy to me.
Korean food wasn't spicy. Kimchi, you know, the Portuguese were the ones that introduced peppers into Korea in like the 1600s.
World travel, saving
dishes. I know,
dishes
it's really
since
crazy.
The 1500s.
Yeah.
So, you know, I keep talking about how, you know, Hanukkah in America has really changed. And this kind of all started around the Civil War in Cincinnati, of all places.
Mm.
So in Ohio, Rabbi Max Lilienthal, he learned about, you know, these Christmas events they were doing for children, because this was also the time that Christmas was becoming very commercialized as well, because people started caring about children.
Yeah, people suddenly realized that children weren't just little workers that can work in mines and factories.
I mean, they did continue that well into now. well into now in some places.
Yeah, but I would say that there was this concerted effort that suddenly children should be children and not just like small little things that can do manual labor with little hands.
Yeah. So people celebrating Christmas are like, oh, this is a way to, you know, spoil our children, you know, one time a year and give them gifts. So, you know, Rabbi Lilienthal sees this and he kind of adapts this for the kids in his own congregation. He has like a Hanukkah assembly where they tell the story and they light candles and they give out candy because, you know, the holidays in general is just an excuse to go crazy and eat a lot of candy, which I appreciate. His friend Rabbi Isaac Wise had a similar event at his congregation, and they edited apparently a national Jewish magazine where they publicized their innovative Hanukkah assemblies, and they encouraged other congregations to establish their own, which kind of leads me to believe that before this, Hanukkah wasn't really celebrated in a congregation, like a synagogue. I'm going to like four Hanukkah things in the next week through the synagogue and the school. So it's kind of crazy that before the Civil War, congregations weren't having Hanukkah celebrations, which is kind of crazy to me.
Well, do you think Hanukkah was just a...
It was a minor
Because it
holiday.
Was a minor holiday, it was just kind of a blip. And if it was going to be celebrated, it's kind of celebrated
at home. Yeah, it was much more of, I think, you know, from what I can guess, from what I've read, it was celebrated at home. It wasn't as much of a communal event. You wouldn't have had Hanukkah parties with your family coming over. It was just like, we're going to light a menorah and then we're going to eat some food.
So pretty much every day.
Yeah, pretty much. It was like basically, it was like a Shabbat thing. It was just kind of like, we're going to light candles and have a meal. But by the 1920s, because Jews are really starting to assimilate into American society, this is fun. Colgate promoted toiletries as Hanukkah gifts, like, you know, things like toothpaste.
Yeah.
Toothpaste, great Hanukkah gift, toothpaste.
I'm a fan. Hey, oral hygiene is very important.
It is.
You know, I will say, I'm sure Hanukkah Harry, I know Santa Claus loves delivering some good
toothbrushes
and toothpaste.
So it also makes a good Hanukkah gift as well.
I can imagine, yeah.
And then candy companies like Barton's, which, you know, you can get a lot of during Passover, they started selling gelt. And this is also fun. Aunt Jemima, America's most racist. What is the word?
Mascot?
Yes. So Aunt Jemima, America's most racist mascot, was making flour proof.
Is it the most racist?
I mean, I don't know. There's
Uncle Ben's up there.
There are a lot of racist mascots that we... The Land of Lakes...
Oh, Land of Lakes.
The Native American girl. They took her away.
They took her off. The Native girl got taken off of the land. Now they're just Land of Lakes.
It's literally just a lake.
With a sunset.
It's a lake with a sunset. I don't know. Aunt Jemima's up there because like...
I mean, Aunt Jemima's bad.
It's pretty bad.
What's that? Bojangles place?
Bojangles.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's pretty bad.
There's a lot of... Okay.
That place is still open.
I know.
Yeah.
There's a lot. So Aunt Jemima, which I believe is the most racist mascot, their flour was proclaiming the best flour for latkes. So people are getting in kind of the marketing of this. The Hadassah newsletter is saying Mahjong sets are very appreciated Hanukkah gifts. I'm assuming for the moms, because traditionally Jewish women love to play Mahjong, which I'd love to figure out why that happened. Yeah. I could do like a whole episode on that. So it starts
Mahjong is really complicated.
It is. There's a group at the synagogue that meets, and I'm kind of like intrigued, but I don't want to be the person that's like, how do I do this? How do I do this?
I'm sure that's how they get people in, though. They're like, okay, now go and study these 300 characters.
I know.
And this is how you play the
but
game.
But I've seen women like, it's great. They go crazy fast. It's a whole thing.
If you ever in New York's Chinatown head down to Columbus Park, you could see the guys playing Mahjong and the other guys around them
are betting.
And like,
yeah,
like
they take it super seriously.
It's very serious.
But you know, Mahjong makes the perfect Hanukkah gift. And it starts to become super commercialized. You know, Jewish women's magazines or printing articles about decorations and gift giving, and it kind of becomes a big part of the holiday. So I think this is happening because Jewish families are doing this to maintain their Jewish identity, which is kind of like distinct from Christian culture, but they're also kind of mirroring Christian culture in America. You know, they don't want their kids to feel left out. Because I feel like people talk about like the magic of Christmas and things like Christmas trees and stockings and decorations, where when they're talking about literally giving you toothpaste for Hanukkah, I feel like
I think that's the SNL skit with Hanukkah Harry, where he shows up and he's like, what did I get? And it's like, you got a belt. It's like, how would you like some black pants?
Yeah, Hanukkah gifts can be fun too. And I think that, you know, sociologists have actually looked into this, that this was a way for Jewish parents to make sure that their kids weren't alienated. So that's really kind of why that happened. And especially in the 1970s, when the Chabad Rebbe, Menachem Schneerson, basically his whole thing was public menorah lightings. This is a very topical thing because a lot of places are canceling their public menorah lightings because of what's going on in Israel and they're concerned about protests. But Chabad was really instrumental in making sure that public menorah lightings were happening all over the place. So he was really instrumental in kind of facilitating that. You know, we have the largest menorah in the world in Central Park.
Wow.
We do. There's a big one they do in Prospect Park too.
And does it say how big it is? What makes it the biggest?
It's very tall.
Oh, okay. It's the tallest menorah.
It's like the biggest, tallest menorah.
Cool.
Okay. So just like, you know, which I think is kind of cool because the public tree lighting, which the second public tree lighting happened in New York. The first one was in Boston. They beat us by 20 minutes.
Boston.
We got to give you something at least. So
I don't know if there's much of like a Christmassy thing in Boston.
No, New York. It's all New York. Again, take our holiday tour and you can learn all about that.
New York is a great one. Actually, Philly does a good Christmas.
Yeah, Philly does a good Christmas. They have a big Christmas market. Mm-hmm. But you know, the idea of like these public Christmas tree lightings, I like the idea that we're kind of mirroring that with menorah lightings and, you know, big public celebrations. And what's kind of exciting is at some point they start celebrating Hanukkah at the White House, which is super cool because what's more American than the White House?
Yeah.
So in 1951.
Yeah, who's the first president to celebrate?
Harry Truman.
Truman.
Truman. In 1951, then Israeli Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion, who I believe shares my birthday.
I feel like that's late.
Truman?
Yeah.
Really?
Well, kind of. I mean, FDR was very, and Eleanor was very friendly toward Jewish people.
Yes. They actually like accused Roosevelt of being Jew. Like he had so many Jews in his cabinet and around him. They were like, is Roosevelt Jewish? But I don't know. Maybe, I don't know. That does make sense. But Harry Truman was the first one to have a menorah in the White House, and it was presented to him by Israeli Prime Minister David Ben-Gurion. And then in 1979, Jimmy Carter took part in the first Hanukkah candle lighting ceremony of the national menorah at the White House, and it was on the White House lawn.
Mm.
In 89, George H.W. Bush displayed a menorah in the White House, and in 1993, Bill Clinton invited a group of school children to the Oval Office for a small ceremony, which I think is kind of cool. In 2008, George W. Bush held an official Hanukkah reception in the White House where he kind of linked the occasion from the 1951 gift. He used the menorah and David Ben-Gurion's grandson and the grandson of Truman lit the candles. So it was kind of like a connection between that, which I think is really
cute.
Cool.
Yeah.
So in 2014, the White House commissioned a menorah made by students at the Max Rain School in Israel. And they invited two of those students to the U.S. to join Barack Obama and Michelle Obama at a celebration that had over 500 guests, which I think is kind of cool.
Did you leave out a couple presidents?
There's no information about a couple of those presents in between. I'm not sure if they celebrated Hanukkah. I know that the first Passover was celebrated during Obama's administration.
Well, I'm kind of shocked that like Reagan didn't have anything, or Ford or Nixon.
They might have, but there's no like LBJ, special information on Kennedy. Yeah, I know. There's a lot of presidents that I'm like, really, Kennedy? Like, you couldn't have gotten... I find it really hard to believe that Jackie Kennedy would not have thrown a Hanukkah party or at least had a menorah in the White House somewhere. Now I want to talk about, as a geriatric millennial, the buzzword Chrismicah, because I remember that when this kind of became a national thing because of...
Oh, my first memory of Chrismicah has got to be the OC.
Yeah.
That is, I remember that was the big thing for a while. And granted, I was living in Orange County at the time. So yeah, anything that happened on the OC was either, you know, embraced fully or eye rolled by anybody who was from Orange County at the time, even just calling it the OC.
So what's it going to be, huh? You want your menorah or a candy cane? Christmas or Hanukkah?
I'm not.
Don't worry about it, buddy, because in this house, you don't have to choose. Allow me to introduce you to a little something that I like to call Chrismicah.
Chrismicah?
That's right. It's a new holiday, Ryan, and it's sweeping the nation.
Hey, fellas, we got the tree.
Hey.
Or at least the living room.
Guys, a little help.
Yeah, just save a spot for you right there. Put your muscle into it.
Excellent.
To the right a little. To the right. Don't hurt it. Those needles are brittle.
That's perfect. You guys. A plus. I love the holidays. I love them all.
We didn't really know how to raise stuff.
Yeah, so I raised myself. And in doing so, I created the greatest super holiday known to mankind, drawing on the best that Christianity and Judaism have to offer.
And you call it Chrismicah. Just hearing you say it makes me feel all festive. Allow me to elaborate.
You see, for my father here, a poor, struggling Jew growing up in the Bronx, well, Christmas, it meant Chinese food in a movie. And for my mom over here, waspy McWasp, well, it meant a tree, it meant stockings and all the trimmings. Isn't that right?
We're very proud.
I'm not a wasp.
Sure you're not. Other highlights include 8 days of presents, followed by one day of many presents. So, what do you think?
Sounds great for you guys.
Do you think that is the first instance of Chrismicah?
If there is an instance before it, I am not aware of it.
So it's actually a lot older than you would think. And like all things Christmas related, it started in Germany.
Oh.
The way we celebrate Christmas in America has a lot to do with our German immigration. So this actually started in Germany in the 19th century with middle class Jews. A lot of them would have what we would now call like a Hanukkah bush, like Christmas trees. You know, Theodor Herzl, who is the founder of Zionism, he celebrated Christmas, or at the very least, he had a tree up in his house for his children, and he suggested they call it a Hanukkah tree. So way, way, way back, we have Hanukkah bushes and Hanukkah trees. And
that's interesting.
Yeah. So there's actually a German word, which I'm going to butcher, Weihnachten, which is a combination of Christmas and Hanukkah. So this is a 19th century Chrismicah word in German. So way, 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 way long a time ago.
Wow.
You know, a lot of German families, you know, especially in the middle class, they were assimilating to German society, which we all know what happened because of that. They it comes up every day, guys. They basically just literally celebrated Christmas, but like as a secular winter festival, not related to the birth of Christ. So they would have, you know, a Christmas tree. They would have stockings.
Well, like many Americans today.
Yeah. So the first historically documented Christmas tree, like we actually have like historical proof of this, was actually erected in Vienna in 1814 by Jewish socialite Fanny von Arstein, who had brought the custom over from Berlin. So the first literal documented Christmas tree was put up by a Jew.
That's so funny.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy. So this all started like way before 2003 with the OC. So if you're not familiar with, you know, this episode, there is a main character, Seth Cohen, whose father is Jewish and his mother is not. So he basically grew up in this interfaith household and they celebrate both. So he kind of combined the words and called it Chrismicah.
Well, was the word called Chrismicah, was that a device of the OC television show? Or what that word you mentioned earlier, the German word, is what they used to refer to it as?
I think the OC is kind of what started the Chrismicah thing. I mean, obviously it existed in German, but I'd never heard the word before, you know, all that with the OC.
Got you. So the German word is the traditional word.
Yeah.
And then the writers of the OC created Chrismicah for this episode.
Because as far as I know, like the creator grew up in a very similar household and that was kind of what he celebrated. So he kind of...
Well, that's kind of the story on Seinfeld of how Festivus came to be, right? That one family actually created Festivus and then the writer decided to put it into an episode of Seinfeld.
Yeah. And I think, you know, with, you know, a lot of Jews marrying non-Jews and everybody kind of want to celebrate holidays and bring their traditions, this becomes super popular. You know, now I think I see a lot of advertisements on even Judaica websites for ornaments. I'll see things like tree toppers. I saw like a matzah box ornament on Modern Tribe, which I thought was really cute, actually. Mm. You know, I'll see dreidel ornaments, Jewish star ornaments, like on Etsy, you know, people are doing that. So I think, you know, maybe a partner, you know, they're not celebrating Christmas, but the partner really wants a tree. Or maybe you're a Jew who really wants a tree because you consider it an American thing. So I think definitely in like the last 20 years, people have really embraced, you know, aspects of Christmas and turned it into Hanukkah. You know, the idea of like a Hanukkah advent calendar, you know, with the candle. If you don't know what an advent calendar is, because I didn't know it until a few years ago, basically it's like a countdown to Christmas and you might get like a little paper thing and you open a door and there's candy inside or you have like a really, really fancy one. So it's basically a countdown for Christmas. But now you can do like a counting up for Hanukkah. It'll be like you add a candle, that sort of thing. Like my daughter has one she made in like a little preschool class. So that's, I think, something that's been adopted from that as well. And other things like pajamas. I did not grow up getting Hanukkah pajamas because these things did not exist. But because a lot of people get pajamas for Christmas, especially on Christmas Eve, Hanukkah pajamas have become a huge thing. I feel like every children's company that I buy clothes from advertised Hanukkah pajamas this year. So it's definitely become a big part of the holiday, I think, because of Christmas.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, are there other things that you see that you're like, that is clearly a knockoff? And I can think of another thing is baking. We have I'm staring at a make your own menorah with frosting kit that I got at Target. And it's definitely reminiscent of like a gingerbread house.
Yeah. Yeah. I think there's a lot that I see that tries to tie at least traditional commercial aspects of Christmas into Hanukkah.
Like what?
In some way. And in some cases, I think they're really culturally ignorant and kind of disrespectful.
There is an Instagram called Hanukkah Fails, which is really funny.
Well, but honestly, it's clearly like some ad rep somewhere decided to have a company, you know, told them, hey, you've got to create Hanukkah stuff. And they just hired some designer to Google search a Hanukkah,
yeah.
Or they Google searched Jewish and then they just pulled images and created like a sweater or created something that is just a little culturally insensitive, I would feel. But there are certain things that I do think are interesting that have become more and more Christmas-esque within Hanukkah that I've even witnessed. Things like houses being decorated with lights.
Yeah.
You know, of course, the Hanukkah bush is the big one with tree toppers that are the Star of David.
Which, interestingly enough, I saw Leopoldstadt, which the first act takes place in Vienna in the late 1800s. And they had like a mixed faith family and they put a Jewish star on a Christmas tree, which I thought was really interesting.
That is interesting.
Yeah. You can Google image that Leopoldstadt and you could probably see that. So clearly this is something that like maybe was even happening, like I was saying, like in the 19th century.
Yeah, maybe that was part of that traditional Christmas celebrating that was going on in Germany back then.
I just feel like, even, you know, my mom talks about, like, I got a doll for Hanukkah. It wasn't like she was getting a present every night. And then when she had us, it's a present every night. And now our daughter is like, it's a present from us every night. And it's a present from my mom every night. And it's a present from my sister every night. So it kind of becomes, you know, it has become super commercialized.
Well, I think it has become more commercialized as Christmas has become more commercialized.
I would agree with that.
You see one holiday, and because Hanukkah's kind of become fairly reactionary now to the aspects of Christmas. I mean, even things like holiday movies, like on Hallmark.
Oh my gosh. We watched a Hanukkah movie that was only like 80% offensive.
But, you know, those Hallmark holiday films that come on that, of course, are traditionally very Christmas-based, but they've now tried to introduce more Hanukkah.
Which I appreciate. I'm all for representation, and I get excited about this merch. I'm not going to lie, I own a lot of it. But it is very telling that we've turned kind of this minor holiday into not a competition with Christmas, but like I said earlier, as a way to make sure that Jewish kids don't feel othered or left out, or like, well, why don't we get to decorate, you know, with frosting and cookies? So it's like, oh, well, we now have a menorah kit, you know, that sort of thing.
Well, I will say, I do think that it is going both ways. That it's not just that Christmas is becoming bigger and bigger and bigger and more commercialized, and it's affecting all of these aspects of celebration within Hanukkah, within American culture. I think that traditional Jewish things that are celebrated around the same holiday as well have now in turn affected Christmas in the sense of things like big blockbuster movies coming out on Christmas Day.
Okay, so this is a thing that my parents used to do in the 80s. They loved to go to movies on Christmas because nobody was there. Because everybody was obviously opening up presents with their family and having breakfast. However, through the course of the 90s, people started to realize that, you know, you have breakfast, you open your presents, like, what are you going to do for the rest of the day until dinner? Oh, we're going to go see a movie. And now...
But traditionally, I believe that it was kind of a Jewish thing to go out and see a movie on Christmas.
And get Chinese food.
And then get Chinese food. And I think the Chinese food thing has now become even more popular, even amongst Christian families who don't want to maybe make a meal.
Yeah.
Hey, what are you going to order? Order Chinese food.
Yeah. So, it's interesting that kind of the holidays have affected each other, especially in America.
All these American things that are happening and the way that certain people who are maybe not celebrating those holidays are now suddenly adopting the ways of that people used to do when these holidays were going on. This idea of 8 days of presents now for some families gets spread out for Christmas over, you know, the entire month. If you're going and visiting a grandparent that's far away, maybe you're going to celebrate that day of gift giving. And then maybe Christmas Eve is a whole nother day of gift giving. And then you have the actual day of
Christmas.
There's
a lot of gift giving. It gets expensive.
Maybe some of these things are, maybe not consciously, but maybe with
they're
embedded within
each other.
Our culture, affecting each other. And possibly, who knows, in a couple hundred years, Chrismukkah might become the norm over two different separate holidays.
It's definitely possible.
Yeah.
So it's been fun talking to you about, you know, some things that I learned and kind of just touching base about Hanukkah in general.
Yeah, it's fun to do these little informational episodes and one that's so topical because it's Hanukkah.
It's starting tomorrow.
Yeah.
So if you're listening, please have a happy Hanukkah or a Merry Christmas if that's what you celebrate.
Crazy Kwanzaa.
Crazy Kwanzaa.
Yeah.
Holidays. Happy holidays.
Girl, it's that special time of year. The festival of lights. But ain't no light shine brighter than the one in your eyes.
Got a week and a day of love for you this Hanukkah, girl. Got a week and a day to show you how much I care.
Got a week and a day of presents for her. Girl shines brighter than any menorah.
When you light the candles, baby, I wanna be there.
I wanna be there.
Candle, you strike the match and say the blessing.
Candle, too.
Your sparkling eyes reflect.
Sing out the prayer we're both expressing.
You make a lock up.
Call it my name.
Got a week and a day of love for you this Hanukkah, girl. Got a week and a day to show you how much I care.
When the world gets sad, our hearts will free us.
Oh, girl, you spin me like a dreidel.
Candle six.
You pick me up when I fall down.
Candle seven.
Then you wrap me like a blaze and rock me like a cradle.
Candle eight.
Your eyes are fires that make me melt.
I don't know how you do.
Eloheinu melech ha'olav, to be with you.
I share my life with you. Bar mitzvah tov.
Vitzivanu lechalich, never leave me.
Shel Hanukkah.